Good evening. How's everyone doing? Good? Great. Thank you all for being here tonight. My name is Stephen Watson. I have the privilege of being the Executive Vice President and Chief Operating Officer, and I'm going to apologize ahead of time. I've got the last bits of my Scottish accent in congestion tonight, so hopefully between the two of those you can understand what I'm saying, so bear with me. This is going to be a really special night. We're going to have a really special panel discussion in conjunction with the exhibit that I hope some of you have had a chance to see, Fighting for the Right to Fight, the story of the African-American experience in World War II. And if you haven't seen it, please take a few minutes tonight after the program to go up to the second floor and see what we have created. We have some really special people on stage with us tonight, and I know we're missing one of our panelists, Leah Chase. She is on her way. She will be here, and we will give her an appropriate welcome when she arrives. You're going to get formal introductions in a few minutes from our moderators, but I just want to say what an honor it is for me to have the opportunity to welcome you and welcome Dr. Cassimere, Dr. Francis, and Leah Chase to be here with us tonight. You all know these folks, I'm sure. You're going to learn some things tonight and hear some great stories. Had a chance to have lunch with Dr. Francis and Ms. Chase on Monday, and it was just remarkable hearing some of their stories. You're in for a real treat. I'd also like to thank several organizations that were really key in getting such a tremendous turnout for this event tonight. The Dr. Norman C. Francis Leadership Institute, the Black Professional, the Martinet Society, and the Urban League of Greater New Orleans Young Professionals. So a round of applause to all of you for helping make this a great success tonight. I'd just like to give you a little bit of a background on the exhibit that this program tonight is built around. In July of last year, we opened Fighting for the Right to Fight, but that was really the culmination of more than 2 years of work that had gone into it from our museum curators, and the most experienced and foremost experts and historians from across the country that really, you know, worked diligently to put this together. We had scholars from Rutgers University, Smithsonian, the University of Georgia, and two local distinguished scholars, one of them being our panelist here tonight, Dr. Cassimere, the other being someone I'm sure many of you know, Dr. Charles Teamer. They worked diligently over a period of 2 years to ensure that this was the best special exhibit that this museum has ever produced, and I think the result speaks for itself. The exhibit is an exhibit that really tells the story of how African Americans who enlisted during World War II to serve their country abroad found really limited opportunities in segregated service. These citizen soldiers would be treated as second-class citizens just in war, just as they had been in their lives in peacetime. But they served with pride, they served with honor, and they served with distinction. And there are some really fantastic stories that are embedded in that exhibit that really get to those points. The exhibit also continues that story of how these veterans that returned from war were really at the forefront of the civil rights movement, working towards what they call double victory. And of course, our panel tonight is a continuation of that story. None of this would have been possible without some generous support. The Coca-Cola Foundation stepped up 3 years ago to provide the funds to help us develop and produce this exhibit, and Entergy has been a generous supporter of the many programs that we've had during the run of this exhibit, including tonight's, and we're really, really grateful for their help. Okay, so I'm almost done, but I have an important task or two before I hand the mic over to our moderators. Do we have any World War II veterans here with us in the audience tonight? If we do, please wave or stand and be recognized. This is your museum, and we're thrilled that you're here for this discussion tonight. I'd also like to ask if we have any veterans that served in later conflicts or peacetime. Please stand, wave, and be recognized. Thank you. So now I'm going to hand the podium over to our co-moderators for this evening, two people that I know you know well, retired WDSU news anchor, veteran of the Marine Corps, Norman Robinson, and current WDSU reporter, and as I found out on Tuesday of this week, a Xavier graduate, Susan Isaacs, and let them discuss the fight for double victory with our esteemed panelists, Raphael Cassimere, Leah Chase, and Norman Francis. So thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. And good evening, and thank you all for joining us here tonight. I've been connected to the museum and the people present here on this stage for many years. I won't say how many. I've been connected with this historic edifice and the visionary men and women responsible for its existence since it opened in 2000. It goes without saying that this is a tremendous asset, not only to the city of New Orleans, but to the entire nation. I am proud to serve as a member of the Community Advisory Board for the museum, and as a former journalist, having had the opportunity to share the stories of the lives, the legacies, and the history of the great men and women who sacrificed, fought, and gave their all for the preservation of this great country. Susan?
All right, thank you, Norman, so much. How is everyone doing this evening? Good. Thank you for coming out. I am truly excited to share this podium with such dignified leaders in our community that set the bar not only here in the city but around the world. And also I would like to thank the veterans here tonight for their dedication and service and commitment to our great country, so thank you.
Dr. Raphael Cassimere. Dr. Raphael Cassimere, Jr. is a native of New Orleans and a product of its public schools. He received his bachelor and master's degree in history from the University of New Orleans and the PhD degree from Lehigh University in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. Dr. Cassimere was a full-time member of the University of New Orleans History Department from 1971 to 2007 and retired with the rank of Serafia de Leda University Teaching Professor, a 2015 Louisiana Board of Regents for Higher Education created the Raphael Cassimere Jr. Endowed Professorship in African American History. Dr. Cassimere has been actively involved with the NAACP since 1960 and held numerous offices in the organization. In July 2015, he attended the 106th NAACP National Convention as a voting delegate for the 54th consecutive year. He also served on a number of governmental boards and commissions, including chairman of the Vucare Commission for 3 terms, as well as a founding member of the Louisiana Black Culture Commission. He is married to Inez Hale Cassimere. They have 1 son and a daughter and 1 granddaughter. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Raphael Cassimere.
And as we mentioned earlier, Ms. Chase is running a few minutes late, but I'm going to go ahead and read her bio. Leah Chase was born on January 6, 1923, in New Orleans and raised in the small town of Madisonville, Louisiana, where there were no high schools for black children. So after the sixth grade, she moved to New Orleans to live with her aunt. In 1946, she married a local musician, Edgar Dickey Chase Jr., whose family owned the restaurant Dickey Chase. Eventually, the two took over the business, which by then had become a sit-down restaurant and a favorite local place gathering place. In a town deeply divided by segregation, Dickey Chase's restaurant was one of the only public places in New Orleans where mixed race groups could meet to discuss strategy for the local civil rights movement. Although such gatherings were illegal through most of the 1960s, Dickey Chase's was so popular, it would have caused a public uproar if local law enforcement had interrupted the meetings. Black voter registration campaign organizers, the NAACP, backdoor political meetings, and countless others often found a home at Dickey Chase's, and Leah cooked for them all. Known as the queen of Creole cuisine, Leah Chase had fed Quincy Jones, Jesse Jackson, Duke Ellington, Thurgood Marshall, James Baldwin, Ray Charles, Presidents George W. Bush and Barack Obama, and countless others as executive chef of Dickey Chase's restaurant. One of the best known and most culturally significant restaurants in New Orleans. New Orleans has more recently served as the inspiration for Princess Tiana in Disney's Princess and the Frog. She has received many awards, including multiple awards from the NAACP and the New Orleans Times-Picayune 1997 Loving Cup Award and the Outstanding Woman Award from the National Council of the Negro Woman, to just name a few. More importantly, she has 4 children, 16 grandchildren, and 26 great-grandchildren.
Miss Leah Chase, ladies and gentlemen. A woman who has a reputation of telling it like it is. I once heard her tell the President of the United States when Mr. Obama was visiting Dickey Chase, she said, "Boy, don't you put no hot sauce on my gumbo." Dr. Norman C. Francis was born and raised in Lafayette, Louisiana. Only 17 when he arrived on the campus of Xavier University in 1948, he quickly emerged as a leader. He graduated with honors from Xavier in 1952. Later that year, Norman Francis became the first African American to attend Loyola Law School in New Orleans. Following graduation from Loyola Law School in 1955, Dr. Francis served in the U.S. Army's 3rd Armored Division. After being honorably discharged from the Army, Dr. Francis worked on special assignment with the U.S. Attorney General to help desegregate federal agencies. In the early days of his legal career, he worked to fight segregation, forging common ground as a mediator and serving as legal counsel to activists. Dr. Francis decided to forego a promising legal practice for a career in higher education, where he thought he could be of greater service. Dr. Francis quickly rose through the ranks to become the first African American and first layman to serve as president of Xavier in 1968. As the nation's longest serving university president, with 56 years of service at Xavier, you may applaud. And 47 of those years as president, Xavier has earned an increasing volume of international and national recognition for outstanding academic achievements under his leadership. While guiding Xavier to higher standards of academic achievement, Dr. Francis has emerged as a singular civic leader and an exceptional statesman. He has served in advisory roles to 8 U.S. presidents on education and civil rights issues and has served on 54 boards and commissions. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Norman C. Francis. As a way of setting the backdrop for what we are about to discuss, I'd like to read an excerpt from an article from History Now, the Journal of the Gilder Lehrman Institute by Clarence Taylor. Clarence wrote, "The Pittsburgh Courier, one of the nation's leading black newspapers, stepped to the forefront in the struggle for racial equality by launching its Double V campaign. Responding to a January 31, 1942 letter to the editor by James G. Thompson of Wichita, Kansas, urging for a Double V campaign, the paper published two interlocking Vs with the theme Democracy, Victory at Home, Victory Abroad in its February 7, 1942 edition. The major objective of the campaign was to encourage blacks to support the war effort but fight for civil rights." End of quote. We start our questions and discussions tonight with my lovely co-moderator, Susan Isaacs.
All right. So let's get this show on the road. So our first question is directed towards Dr. Cassimere. We're not calling out your age, okay? But you were born shortly after World War II started, so you don't really have any memories of it. But later in life, and perhaps particularly when advising on the content of this special exhibit, how did you find yourself connecting to the war? Miss Leah Chase.
First of all, let me say how very pleased I am to be in the presence of greatness. I have known each of these individuals for over 50 years, and they have really enriched our community, the world community, because, of course, their contributions are known not just here in New Orleans and Louisiana, but all over. I was born during World War II, and most of my memories are from my relatives. I had seven first cousins and three second cousins who served in the war. I had a half-brother who was in the Navy. Unfortunately, he died a year after the war ended, so I didn't know very much from him. Most of the memories I have of the war, I really gained afterwards. In trying to prepare for this panel, I was trying to think about anecdotes I may have received from some of my relatives who served in the war, and I don't remember any of them having anything bad to say about their experiences. I learned when I was at Clark High School, any Bulldogs here? When I was at Clark High School, our principal used to tell us about how the black soldiers would have to wait for the movies to be shown to the white American soldiers and then German prisoners. So I began to get some sense about segregation worked in the armed services. But most of the black veterans I knew, not just my relatives, but also neighbors and some of my school teachers, apparently had a much more balanced view of what the war was. Things got better. The fact that they got better doesn't mean that they were good. Sometimes better is better than they were. Remember, most of them had come up through the ravages of the Depression. When they were in the service, at least they had a job and they ate regularly. They experienced discrimination, but probably not much different from what they left behind in places like Harlem or in Chicago and Philadelphia here in New Orleans. And while they were fighting for what the leaders of the black community called the double victory, they were getting paid. Many of them had not had jobs. And of course, they not only got paid, but many of them had allotments that they sent home to wives or to mothers or other relatives. And they had a chance to move out of the communities where they lived. So it was an exciting experience. In fact, I can remember any number of those veterans talking about how good things were during the war. And they were talking economically. They had jobs. You got to be a man. It was an experience that many of them had never forgotten about. But as I got involved, particularly as an academician, and began to do research on it, it was not a very good time for black Americans, whether they were civilians or whether or not they were involved in the services. There were riots in a number of places. There were blacks, of course, who were beaten upon by civilians who were arrested unfairly by the police. Sometimes military police were no better. The NAACP, which I joined in 1960, its records in the 1940s were replete with complaints from soldiers, many of them who had come from the North, who were not trying to make any changes in the prevailing racial order, but who were not used to segregation on the subways in Chicago or in New York, and who innocently sat in any open seat in New Orleans, did not understand the segregated seating patterns in the transit, and were arrested and were charged. Or some people who happened to be in the wrong neighborhood because they mistakenly made the wrong turn. I learned about that after the fact, but talking with a lot of the people who actually served at that particular time, and even people who later on talked about, you know, things were good. My father, for example, mentioned during the Depression, he was lucky if he could work 20 hours a week. During the war, he might work 70 hours. My mother worked, and older sisters had little odd jobs. So it was a time for people to increase their economic capacity even while their civil rights were being ignored. But one thing I remember from an older woman who was later secretary of the NAACP, and she told me she had her first encounter with racism when she was 4. And she was born around the turn of the century when some white woman called an N, and she threatened to hit her in the head with a garbage can. But she said, you know, one of the things I remember, because I had lived under Huey Long, and Huey Long had made promises to make things better for poor whites, and Franklin Roosevelt came along with his New Deal, and things got a little bit better for poor whites, that things really don't change very much unless you make them happen. And she mentioned she had been involved in the Garvey movement in the 1920s, and she got involved in the NAACP movement in the 1930s, but that most people were too busy just trying to survive. And she wasn't saying it in a critical manner. She wasn't suggesting that they should have been involved. She was saying most people were just simply trying to survive. But they did respond when they saw changes. And when there were positive changes, people began to get hope. And so, of course, out of the war, the rationing caused people to save. And once the war ended, there were people, of course, who had money to buy homes. My parents bought their first home after World War II. People got the first automobile. And many of those veterans, of course, people who taught me, took advantage of the GI Bill, went back to school, got better education. Dr. Francis knows about it. My close friend, late friend Llewellyn Sonyak, talked about the education expansion at Xavier High. A lot of those veterans who were older than him came back, and things got better. But as things got better, people began to realize they can get a whole lot better. And many of them became more actively involved in the movement as a result. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Chase, first I'd like to say congratulations on the restaurant celebrating its 75th year, and you, your 93rd. Your question is, what impact did the war have on your livelihood?
What impact the war had on me?
On your livelihood.
On my life. A lot. Some good, some bad. As Mr. Cassimere, but he's too young to know, I was born in, 1923, so the big depression came in, 29, and we didn't see daylight till 40, 41, so all that time, I was in that poverty cycle. And I witnessed a lot of things in the small town I came up in. People called you names, but you went by them and you went on. My daddy was one who told us just ignore things and keep working. And that's all we did. They always told you just ignore them and keep working. So I had to fight poverty along with segregation, along with everything. So when the war came along, it was good and it was bad for me because I saw my cousins. I didn't have brothers. My mother had a dozen girls before she had a boy. And the boys didn't come till way down the line. So we were all girls. So we didn't have brothers to go, but our cousins and our good friends served in the war. So we were left without boyfriends and without the male friends that we had. But we had to fight poverty. So when that war came along, it was a little bit more opportunities for people like me because the men were going off to war. So I had a job. This was the funniest ad I ever answered. And this was an ad in the Times-Picayune. I was only 18 years old, had to come to New Orleans because the only work I could do at home was housework, wash clothes, and do this, that, and the other. So, you know, I wanted a little bit better, so I came here. And when I read this ad, the ad said, light-skinned colored girl. Yep, that was the ad. They described what they wanted. If it was a heavy black man and blah, 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 blah. That's the way the ads read. I said, well, I'm not light-skinned, but I'm going to take the chance. I'm going to give it a shot. So I did, and I got this job as a waitress. Now, that was really something else because the men used to wait tables. They didn't have women then waiting tables. It was all the men, and the men had gone, so they had to hire people like me who didn't know anything. I had never seen the inside of a restaurant in my life. Because it was segregation and we didn't have restaurants to go to. I came from a small town that was nothing. And African Americans ate at home a lot because there were no places for them to go. So when I got in that restaurant, I thought it was just the most beautiful thing I'd ever, to be able to fix food, to be able to learn food, but most of all, to be able to meet people, you know, to feed everybody. Like, you know, even Doris Duke. I fed Doris Duke, fed Ricky Alvarez, all the artists up there. And people have always fascinated me. I just love people. So that was a good thing for me. But I still had to remember the people that I left home. The men that were going to war and we didn't know where they were. You know, they couldn't tell you where they were. So my brother-in-law, who was not married yet to my sister, used to write home, and we would read his letters, and they would, if he was on Guam, the first letter said G, and the last Guam, until he spelled out Guam when we put it together. But they didn't tell you where those people were. And that was hard, too, because you didn't know where your people were. And the war was something else to me. It was frightening because I remember listening to the radio, listening to Mussolini go through Ethiopia and Paulo Haile Selassie fighting for his country and trying to do the best he could for this country. And that worried me. As a little girl, that worried me. How you could do this and how this could be and how. But you live, you go on, and you do the best you can do with what you have. Because I came from a family that my parents always told us, just keep going. That's all they ever told you was just keep working. If you work, you can get anything. Now, here my daddy was with all those girls, 12 girls, no boys. And his brothers had boys, so and they would really criticize Daddy for that, you know? And he would always defend us. He said, but my girls could do anything. They could work and they could do things. So we were always taught that even though we were girls, we could take care of ourselves. And my mother raised 11 of us. So 9 girls and 2 boys, and we did. We did it all. And we learned to do everything. Was it easy? The war was going on, but it brought us a little bit more money. We had money that we didn't see before. We didn't know what money was. You know, you went, you planted your food and you swapped it off for this and swapped it off for that. And you began to have work. My daddy worked at a shipyard along with farming. So we had work in the little town that we had never had before. And it was just so, we were so happy to get that work and to be able to pay the grocery lady and pay, and daddy was one. You had to pay your bills. Please pay your bills. They were, oh yeah, you couldn't owe anybody. If you wrote your name and got you some beans or rice or whatever it was, as soon as you got your money, go pay the bills. And he go pay the tuition, you know, because we, he was, my daddy was more Catholic than the Pope. You had to go to Catholic school. So you had to get that little 50 cents a month tuition and pay everything off. Because he said, if you die owing anybody anything, you're going to hell. So we didn't want to go to hell, so we paid off those bills. And I think that's still my mentality. Pay off the bills because you're going to hell. But it was rough times. But you know what? Black people survived it all. How we did it, we couldn't tell you today. We had civil rights people come in and people say, well, Leah, what did we didn't have time to document anything. We just did what we had to do and keep going and try to do better. And with the civil rights movement, and Mr. Cassimere can tell you, we did a lot in that restaurant. We fed them all. So, yeah, and did it all. But those were just bad days. But you look at bad days, you don't harp on them. You use that to build, and you build. And every day you say, it's going to be better. It's going to be better. So we survived it all. And here we are today. And I'm still here working because they told me I have to work or die. So I don't want to die, so I'm still working.
Dr. Francis, you were in middle and high school during the war. What memories do you have of that time?
Of what?
During World War II.
Well, you know, I've been listening to these two people alongside of me, and we're almost in the same generation, though Miss Chase is a little older than we are. And this, for me, is a teachable moment to be here and to hear the two of them and to say a little bit about my own experiences. Let me start by saying I was 11 years old, of course, when World War II started. And if you can think about those years, and I'm going to try to put in the context and then do the teachable moment. My father had 4 children at that time. And of course, the Great Depression and the 21 Depression and everything else, when people had a ration, didn't have money at all. And maybe we were just about to see the light, this country now. Not poor people like all of us. Here comes World War II. And then we were repeating what happened in the Great Depression. What World War II did, certainly for me, was as an 11-year-old, watching soldiers come in my little hometown and sleep on the cots at the school, and I'd go get them cigarettes and sodas and so forth, and they'd ship off to Alexandria to go to war. That was a strange sight, because here I was watching young men who had been drafted, many, some were not, and they were gonna go on to fight a war. Now, in that context, think of this 11 to 12, 13-year-old going through that war at home and having to ration. My mother and my father had to ration, everybody did. Sugar, coffee if you drank it, rice, shoes. And it taught a disciplining about how to make it without having everything. Because you didn't have to have everything to make it as long as you had the determination that you believed in God, had faith. And I have to tell you, God had to have given black people more faith than he gave anybody else. And people ask me, I was with my classmate, Moon Landrieu, Monday, teaching a senior class at Tulane. And the young man, after we went through all of this stuff, we've done this before, he said, well, what did faith have to do with this? So Moon said everything. And I said, well, I wouldn't be here if I didn't have faith. Why? I had already graduated, undergraduate, gone to law school, had a law degree, went to the service and stayed 2 years as a private and a lawyer. They found out I was a lawyer about a year, Norman, after I was there, and said to me, and I was in General Patton's peacetime army, the tankers. And he said, what the hell are you doing in here in the medical battalion and you're a lawyer? I said, you didn't ask me. I said, I'd have told you where I wanted to be. But he said, well, we're going to make you a JAG officer. You're going to be a commissioned officer, lieutenant. Now, I'm a private, and I did everything a private did. For those of you who are servicemen, you know what privates did, everything. And I said, well, I'm going to be a lieutenant. I was older than most of the lieutenants in there. Who was over us. And I said, well, how long do I have to stay? He said, well, that's a 2-year commitment. I said, I've already given you one as a private. He said, well, you're gonna do two more. I said, no way. I saluted, and I said, I'm going home. I'm going home as a private, and I'll stay the rest of my life as a private. But these are the teachable moments. I was taught by parents who never went to high school. And they taught me really everything I needed to know about life and living and being disciplined and not crying about what you didn't have, use what you did have. Now, I suppose we were poor. I didn't know we were poor. I really didn't. My khakis were always ironed and so forth, and we lived in a way in our own world. But that world was a marginalizing world that should have made us all lose our minds, but we didn't. Now, I've given a lot of talks around, and I'm going to say this now, and I'll say it a few little words later. I spoke to the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals judges about in May, and they read this long resume about what I had done and so forth and so on. And after I got up to speak, I said, well, let me tell you something. The folks introduce you, and they tell all these beautiful stories about the speaker because they want you to feel good that you're going to get the best speech in the world from the smartest man or woman up there. All right, Norman? I said, well, let me tell you who I really am. So I was brought up in a little country town, supposed to be poor. My mother and father didn't graduate from high school. And I lived 34 years under Plessy. Now, they were all lawyers. So I didn't have to explain that. I lived 34 years under separate but equal, like the servicemen that gave me the determination. I was in Xavier at the time this man was playing little football, getting ready to leave, and all these other servicemen. I hadn't been to the service yet to be a private, see. I got taught how to be the private before I got there. I got a disciplining from men who had gone to the war. Some had been drafted, some had graduated, some were going, had already started, and who came back because they had gone around the world. They saw what you had to learn to be in a competitive society. They used the GI Bill, And I mean to tell you, one good story about it, these guys would go to school from 8:30 on a Monday morning till 4 o'clock on Friday evening, and they left on the weekend, and they didn't come back until 8:30 Monday morning. I don't know what the hell they did during that time, but I got a good idea. But my point is, I was 17, 18 years of age, having gotten this background from my mother and my father about you got to be good, you got to be educated, you got to do the best you can, and you got to be better than anybody else. You don't think you're going to make it. You got to be better than everybody, then hope you're going to make it. And so I was prepared. I was prepared with that kind of a feeling and the like. But I tribute to my mother and my father, whom I think has met all of ours, were the greatest psychologists in the world. Every day that we lived under Plessy, we were living under, you can't go there, you can't go here, and you can't do this, and you can't try on that hat, you know. And I'll stick this in right now anyway. They still do it. Go into a store, now, lawyer, president, and a guy sees me, and he says, Norman, what can I do for you? I say, did I go to high school with you? He said, no, I don't think so. I say, if I didn't, then you call me Mr. Yeah. Now, I'm saying this to say that formed me to be an example for all of the young people that I chose and passed up being a millionaire lawyer. I will end with this, and then we'll get some other questions. I got a whole lot else to say. These are, for me, it's a teachable moment. And it's not me. It's what I would say you look at, because I've taught and gone to those schools, and they say, oh, you got to be president. You were born with a silver spoon in your mouth. No, I was not. I didn't have a silver spoon in my mouth. And exactly. And my point is, and this is what I said to the judges, I said, after all of what I went through, I could have been mad, I could have torn up the barracks and all that other stuff, but I said, I never lost faith in myself. I never lost faith in my God, and I didn't lose faith in my country. My country. So that's what World War II did for me. Now, Norman, we're ready to go.
Yes, sir. I got a lot more questions for you. You know, as I was sitting here listening to all three of them share with us tonight, I couldn't help but think how privileged and blessed we are to have them as assets in our community. I'm reminded of an old gospel hymn that says, give me my flowers while I yet live, so that I can smell the fragrance and see the beauty they bring. We're giving you your flowers tonight, and you are in turn giving us the energy from which to continue to grow our humanity. Thank you very much. Now, this question is open to whomever wants to answer it. All three will have an opportunity, but whomever feels the energy to answer first is open to go first. And this question is, how, in your opinion, panelists, did the experiences of both veterans and people on the home front help shape the civil rights movement?
I think it helped in a lot of ways, because when people came back, for me, it was unbelievable. For me, I had a job. I worked a job, and I learned a lot. Met a lot of people, and I'm, as I said, I'm a people person. And if you meet somebody like Doris Duke, you meet the big people, you said, well, maybe one day I'll be there, I'll go there. So you scuffle and you work hard. And you know, like people said, you couldn't buy this, you couldn't buy that. I didn't have the money anyway to buy it. So it didn't pain me. Like, I just couldn't reach that goal. I couldn't get in those doors. And all I wanted to do was somebody to open the door for me. And if you open that door, I felt I could do what I had to do, but there were no doors open. So that was a hard thing to deal with, because I was kind of I was a little bit militant, huh, Mr. Cassimere? Dr. Cassimere, I think I was a little militant, I don't know. But I always strived to see and to do better and to have better things. So it opened doors for me that I couldn't get in before. And life has been like that for me, because when I started in here, as I said, I didn't know anything. I had never been in a restaurant. I didn't know one earthly thing. Then I always wanted one for myself and couldn't get it, didn't know how to get it. And when I married Dookie, well, his father had his son. So I got in there. But then they had just a sandwich shop. So I had come from the other side of town and wanted to do better and had to bring it to my own people, what I saw over there. And that was a hard job for me. But there are people that helped me, that made me. Dr. Francis is one, because he belonged to an organization, the Boule, it was called. Don't ask me what it means, I don't even know, the Boule. Anyway, but it's an organization of professional men. And at that time, they could go and eat different places, some in their homes. And when they were able to go in the hotels, well, naturally, they went in the hotels. So then they came to me and they said, Dr. Francis said, well, we can eat here. Now, you're eating in the hotels. I don't know what you're eating over there. And I know what I'm cooking over here, fried chicken and fried fish. You know what that? But they taught me that. They taught me that we want lobster, we want this, we want that. So here I go into the books and get everything out and try to learn. Then there was another group, Dr. Francis, that came to me, was Phil Johnson, Scoop Kennedy, Peter Mayer, and old Mr. Alcatraz was living then. Rebus Antique was with you, uh-huh. But then these people came to me and they said, we want you to serve us lunch to this gourmet club. Now, I didn't know one thing about what I'm gonna serve these people, like Mr. Alcatraz, who owned Antoine's, and Peter Mayer and Scoop Kennedy and all those people. So they said, and we want Campari and soda. I don't even know what Campari is. So you see, they had to teach me that. But it's people that helped you along the way. Rebus Antique and Dr. Francis helped me on that side. Phil Johnson and his group helped me to grow. So people help you, and I'm so grateful to all of them. So it's a whole different world for me, but I'm still learning. I'm still here and still learning. And then when I had to work with Aretha Haley and those people, that was another thing that we didn't understand, because none of us wanted our children to go to jail. We would think about having our children go to jail, but they were willing to go to jail for what they believed in. Now, we had worked with the NAACP, with Thurgood Marshall, Mr. Turo, and all those, A.P. Turo and all. But you know, they were good people. They wanted what they wanted, but they didn't want to offend anybody. We can't offend the people. You know, we were taught that way. That's the way we were brought up as Black people. No matter what you did to us, we were not gonna hurt you. We didn't want to offend you. We thought that wouldn't get us anywhere. I offended people. But these young people said, we going. And I didn't understand the movement, but I had to feed you. So over a bowl of gumbo and some fried chicken, they went. And that is a wonderful thing. And I think we should do that today. Sit down over a bowl of gumbo and some fried chicken and solve all these problems.
That would work for me, yeah. Dr. Cassimere.
I think it broke down barriers. You began to see people differently. In fact, I remember at lunch at Ducky Chase, there was a veteran, he was a white guy, who mentioned how his whole unit had their leave canceled because there was one white guy who had on the dirty shirt. Now, all of the myths that we had growing up with, whites were smarter and they were cleaner and so forth. You got a chance to meet and interact with people and begin to see them differently. And as these soldiers moved to different parts of the world and they saw that blacks were not always treated the same way as we often were in the South, and you begin to see the world differently, the way it could be, and of course the fact that you had to. I met a lot of veterans. In fact, I met a number of veterans who were actively involved in the NAACP, whose views had been shaped by their sacrifices during World War II. Being excluded from officers' camps, even though they had commissions. Blacks, for example, who were not allowed in the same hospitals that whites were in, who would not have been involved in civil rights before, but now they were confronted with it. They were treated with such indignities that and injustice that they decided, well, something has to be done. A lot of them came back and got involved in little things like getting involved in voter registration, trying to have the same rights as whites. Mr. Chase mentioned trying on hats. Have the right to try on clothes before you bought them. That was not something that we took for granted in Louisiana. But the one thing I remember, one of the veterans who got very actively involved, he mentioned he was in both World War II and in Korea. And he talked about the differences that had taken place between the time that he got out in 1946, and he thought he could make it as a civilian, but he realized that probably had more opportunities. And so he went back when the Korean War, and he talked about the changes that had taken place just in that five-year period. And he mentioned he began to realize, well, if we have these kind of changes that take place in the military, we could probably make those kind of changes in the civilian world as well.
Thank you. I'd like to start with, again, another teachable moment. What the civil rights movement taught us was fighting for the rights, keeping our focus, and willing to pay the highest price. Didn't matter. And I'm not sure. Now, again, you remember that I gave up my millionaire lost job and got with the poorest organization in the United States, a poor black college where nobody had money to pay to come. So I thought, and I think I fulfilled that in many ways, and I'm pleased with that with the people I've worked with, that we are coming full circle. What I saw, you saw, what all happened, it's happening again. Now you can quote me later on, if you get reporters. The next civil rights movement is going to be on education. And how are you going to handle that? You'll have to take lessons from the civil rights movement of the 50s and the 60s. And that you are going to have different people doing different things, but working together for that one cause. The Marines had to take one part, the Army had to take one part, and the rest. Civil rights movement had to have the NAAC, the Urban League. It had to have SNCC, and it had to have NAACP, all of the civil rights organizations, and they almost all of them were located in the old French hospital on All East Avenue. I met John F. Kennedy when he was trying to run for office, hadn't been there, in the old French hospital, and all of the civil rights movements were there. my point is, and I hope, and people ask me, what would I tell young people? I'd say, first of all, get educated. The road out of poverty is education. The road to better jobs is education. And the other one is to have faith and to not lose your head when things get tough. And to know who you are, where you've come from, and to be prepared for it. So the next civil rights movement is going to be rougher than the one that we've just come out of, believe me. And I say that to you, if you don't believe me, I got some land in Lake Pontchartrain and I want to sell you. When I sit and listen, I'm old enough, you know, not your age, but I'm old enough. I spent my time as a president, and he leaned over and asked me, 54 organizations. Yes, you know why? I wanted to know who was making these decisions that had all of these unintended consequences, making the SAT and call it an aptitude, scholastic aptitude. That wasn't scholastic aptitude. That was achievement. And the smart people taught kids to achieve. You know, not aptitude. You try to get into any of the school, even Xavier. You tell, I got aptitude. I say, you better have more than that. you better have a little English in math. My point is, it's going to be a tough world. And so we fought some things. You look around. Every time I read the paper, they're trying to change the Voting Rights Act in states. And they're going to do it. And all the people who fought for us to have voting rights and the like, you know, that's going to, why? Don't want people to vote. What is the NAACP's motto? A voteless people is a hopeless people. Yeah. So we got to vote. We got to we've got to remember what the past was, or we're going to repeat it. It's being repeated. There are more poor people in this country today, both black, white, brown, you name it. And it is not a black problem. Surely we're disproportionate. It's an American problem. How are we going to solve that? Education and all the rest. My only point in saying to this audience, we've made great progress. I have great faith, and that's what the civil rights movement to them. I got to tell you, we're going to battle. We're going to battle, and it is going to start before you believe.
Thank you. We have this question slated for a little later in the program, but since you broached it, now's a good time. You know, I believe in moving forward. Mrs. Chase mentioned that she was militant. Dr. Francis talked about strategy. Dr. Cassimere talked about what it was like to face barriers and to hurdle some of those challenges. Since you were addressing your remarks, Dr. Francis, to the young people, would you share with them, then Mrs. Chase, how you maintained your bearing and what influenced that bearing from your experiences in the World War II and post-World War II era?
Am I on now? Yes.
Yes.
I covered a lot of it, but if I was sitting talking to, as I have had an opportunity incident while I was in the Army as a private, I lived with 18-year-olds. Imagine that. I counsel more folks than you can shake a stick at. And what I would say to young people today, you quit fooling around with you think you're going to be the next Michael Jordan or you're going to be this or that. You go get yourself educated. Choose your friends wisely. Know what your goal is going to be. You might not know it clearly that I'm going to be this or that. God knows, I never thought I'd be a college president. Rethink that. But get your goal, set it, work at it, don't let anybody turn you around, and don't let your friends say, hey, something, you think you a big shot, going to school, learn, you learn everything you can. And I remind them, and I do this in little schools, I say, you know, you started school in first grade, and 50% of the folks you started with are not with you, and you're just leaving seventh grade or eighth grade, you know, like. It's a sad state. So my point is, teach, education, focus, but for me, more than anything else now, is to respect yourself, respect other people, and then go about your business of achieving your goals, because it's a bigger world now. And the young people I talked to knew more about life in when they were 15 than it took me 30 years. But my point is, Norman, it's putting in their heads, you've got to remember you are a special creature. God made you different from anybody else. You got certain talents. You got to use them. And don't let your crazy friends talk about, oh, I don't know if you were to say, I'm going this way. You can go that way if you want to. And be a leader wherever you are. And I said, young people can be leaders anywhere. People start talking off the wall. Don't be silent. You know, at least I learned as a lawyer that sometimes you have to speak, and sometimes you keep your mouth shut, you know. But in leadership roles where you can make a difference, tell your friend, now that's not right. Don't be talking about Miss Chase. You don't know Miss Chase, you know. Yeah. And if you go do talk right. My only point, Norman, is, and you know, some of those young folks say, you're trying to tell me how to dress and all that. You treat me like children. Well, if you act like children, you know, you treat you like children. You're not going anywhere if you don't respect yourself. So when you go out, you ought to be at least dressed decently. You ought to speak at least proficiently as you can. And you ought to respect people. And you'll have a full roadway out of poverty.
Thank you. Mrs. Chase.
It's all right. It's all right there. You know, we have to go back, Dr. Francis and Mr. Cassimere, to the way we were brought up, and that's the way black people lived one time. You know, we lived that we were proud to be who we were. I can tell you, when I came up in this small town here, it was the richest man in the town. He owned the whole dumb town. I lived next door. He didn't give us a penny or didn't try to help us do anything. But I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt, because black people then, you couldn't give us too much. We wanted to earn it. And daddy used to say, "Don't, if they're giving you anything, don't take it. It's not worth anything anyway if they're giving it away." So you had to work for everything. And I think sometimes maybe they thought they would insult us by giving us things. Today you have corporations that are coming in to help people. But you take advantage of that, and you build on it, and you do what you have to do. But it's hard to make people understand that today. For one thing, they don't respect authority, and that is bad. As Dr. Francis said, they don't respect themselves. You know, we were proud people. That jar of Vaseline they bought, brushed your hair, put it on your skin, shined your shoes, everything with a jar of Vaseline. But we were proud. You didn't go out unless you were shiny. You know, put that Vaseline on your hands. Be shiny. Be, look clean. Look when you go out. And sometimes we have to go back to that. We have to go back to who we were and just remember that. We did a lot. And when I think about it, I think the mistake that was made, but times make a difference in what you can do. Times always make a difference in what you can do. If you had educated that black man, look at the resources you lost. Look at the resources. Now they begin to realize that if I educate this man, I can better my country. I can better this and I can better that. But as I said, times make a difference in what you do. You remember A. Philip Randolph tried to make that march on Washington in the 40s. He tried, couldn't do it. 20 years later, here comes King, gets it done. So you can't give up, and that's what we were taught. Don't give up. Don't give up. Just keep moving, and that's all I do. They say, well, Miss Chase, you know, this one don't like me. Well, if he doesn't like you, that's his problem. Mm-hmm. If you don't like me, that's your problem. But, you know, you just dust your shoes off and keep going, and keep going, and you have to do that. You have to have confidence in yourself. I'm a big one on prayers. I believe in praying every day. I got to the point where I don't ask God anymore. I tell him.
There you go. You're familiar with it now.
I tell him. I said, look, and I get up in the morning, look, God, I got to get out here. You know, I got to do this work. So you got to take me out there, and you got to bring me back. When I go back, I say, thank you. So my my daughter say, God's going to get pretty well tired of you getting there. But that's all you have to do, and that's what we lost. And that's what we have to get back, and we have to get to working together. That is the whole thing. Work together. If we can work, I don't have to come to your house. You don't have to come to my house. But I got to work together to make our city better, to make our state better, to make our country better. We have to work together. So it's coming along. I'm not giving up. I got a few more years, so I'll hang in there.
We're going to hang in with you. Dr. Cassimere.
What's your question?
The question was, which one of us is 65? The question was, in what way did the experiences of World War II and post-World War II influence your bearing on how you handle Jim Crow?
The elders I had, my grandmother, my maternal grandmother probably had as much influence on me as anybody, my parents and my teachers. But my grandmother once said, and never forgot, and something that Dr. Francis mentioned, 50 cents you earned is better than a dollar that somebody else gives you. Because if you earn it yourself, you can appreciate it better than somebody else. But my grandmother always used to tell us, be somebody, you have to look like somebody. And she mentioned, say, when I go do business, they don't call me girl, they don't call me Lucy, they call me Mrs. Elon because I act like somebody. And so one of the things you have to do, if you are somebody, then you act like somebody. And one thing I would often tell my students, being somebody is a full-time job. You can't be somebody part of the time and a nobody part of the time because somebody might see you being nobody. And that's the only time they see you. And so you've lost an opportunity to demonstrate that you're somebody. I think I had four of my former students who came up to me tonight, and I felt good about it, whether they were telling the truth or not, to say, I came because I saw you were on the program. And so if you demonstrate to somebody that you know that you're somebody, and that's a big problem I find that so many people have, even people with money, they don't feel good about themselves. They're insecure about who they are. And if you don't feel that you're anybody, you're going to try to pull somebody down because you're down. You're not going to pull people up, but you feel insecure yourself. But I remember Roy Wilkins used to often tell us, don't be loud, be smart. You don't have to tell people what you're going to do. Dr. Francis may remember Charles Houston, who doesn't get very much credit, but he is really the architect for overturning segregation. And he came up with a plan for destroying segregation by chipping away at it, a little bit at a time, and when it came time, 3 or 4 years before Brown, most people didn't realize how far he had come. You don't have to tell people what you're going to do. There are people who use the term militants, and I remember, to his credit, Malcolm X, shortly before he died, said, to really test his militants, he had to come south. It's one thing to get up on a ladder and haul them and say bad things about white people. It's different to come to Mississippi. Jackson, he didn't get a chance to come south to test his militants. So if you tell people in advance what you're going to do, they know what you're going to do. You don't have to tell them everything. The other thing, I was talking to somebody before we began, we have a lot of poor people who are so much better off than when we were and didn't know that we were poor. Poor people who don't know how to live like poor people, want to live like rich people, want to pretend that they are who they're not. But if you have somebody, the clothes won't tell who you are. If you act like somebody, somebody's going to see you. And somebody will want to emulate you. So I had people who had gone through these experiences, my teachers, my parents, my neighbors and relatives, and I learned from them. That's how a man acts. That's how you're supposed to act when you are somebody within the community.
All right, so we have one last question before we open the floor to the audience for a Q&A. In one sentence, what do you think is the most important aspect of World War II that young people should know?
Repeat it.
In one sentence, what do you think the most important aspect of World War II that young people should know?
Well, first thing they ought to know is that people went to war and sacrificed everything they had, and they did not, quote, run away from war. They lived up to that. When they swore and took that oath, they lived up to it. The 99th, you're going to see upstairs in the Red Tails. Some of you have seen the movie The Red Tails. My brother-in-law was a member of the 99th. He was a colonel, and by the time he was ready to go, but I'll tell why he left. And if you saw Red Tails, you remember the guy that was one young man flying in the squadron, Bill Davis Jr., whom I got to know, was leading the folks going back to the base, and his young guy in the back got shot down. My brother-in-law figured, well, I'm gonna go get him and save him. They got 50 Germans all around shooting, he's gonna go save him. And what happened to him, he got shot down too. And he's the one that was, my brother-in-law was shot down, was put in a German stag-lag POW, and he escaped. He escaped. And I spent a lot of time with him in Frankfurt when I was, interesting, you know. Humility is a great thing, you know, and I'm as humble as it can be. I never worry about who I am in terms of trying to impress somebody. He'd come to the barracks and he'd say, he's a colonel, got his all them bars on, and he'd go there and say, what are you here for? He said, I've come to see Private Francis. The guy said, Private Francis? Where you want to go to? That's my brother-in-law. Oh. And he knew everything in Franklin to imagine. How do you know that? He said, well, I was shot down, got back, and I was in Franklin, so I learned everything I needed to know. He left the army because the army did not move him from a colonel to a brigadier general. He had people whom he had supervised who were getting brigadier generals. And here's a man got shot down, captured, escaped, came back and shot down some more planes. He should have got everything, should have been made a general. Clinton did make B.O. Davis Jr. a general. He was the head of the 99th. My point in saying that to you is that I made the point earlier about you got to respect and all that other thing, but you got to respect other people, and the future in the movement is not going to be just black folks trying to do good. It's going to be men and women of goodwill, black, white, all of us doing one thing, making America fair, just, and hopefully peaceful. So that when I look at what it is that I hope that came from my time, that the young people saw, I knew everybody on the campus. I knew the gardener. I knew the people who were painting. I worked my way through painting, and I'd stop and say to him, what are you doing? He said, I'm painting this door. I said, well, did you sand it? No. I said, you got to sand the door first. And then you got a dust cloth, you can wipe the sand off, and then you put the, and I see him every day, and he say, how do you know all of that? I said, I did exactly what you did for 2 years, to pay my way through high school, and then I shined shoes for 2 years. Whoa, shine shoes. No, I wasn't too proud to shine shoes. Exactly. My point is that we are gonna all have to work together, and not all of your skin folk are your kin folk. All right? Yes, remember that. Remember that. So that we all have our prejudices and all of that other stuff. We can't practice what we had experienced. That doesn't mean we have to, you know, walk in the store and have everybody call you by your first name. No, you can tell them, you know, I'm spending money here. You're going to respect me and the rest. Mom, what I'm trying to say to you, we're going to have to hold hands together, and we're going to have that common goal and make what we know that Constitution intended for all of us and make it without apologizing for it. Remember I said we're Americans, and that's what you're going to see in that. Well, I'm making a plug for the exhibit already. You're going to go up and see men who said, I'm a man, I'm an American, I want to fight, let me fight, because I'm prepared to fight. So my point is that I would expect that if anything that I would want to have chosen, one is to be humble enough and not arrogant enough after you got educated to think that you're better than anybody else and that you're free to do anything else. Freedom is not free. I don't care who you are. You walk in the theater and holler fire. See where you'll be the next day, in jail. You're not free to do anything you want, and know there are limitations. And I say that because we're seeing people every day who think they are so important that they don't have to be concerned about other folks in the life. That's not going to make it in the future. So men and women of goodwill, we're going to have to be together, and it's going to be all of us. If you think I've got a hole in my side of the boat, you better stop getting a bucket, because we all in the same boat together, okay? Thank you, ma'am.
All right. Now let's open the discussion to you all. If you all have a question for one of our panelists, we're going to ask that you please raise your hand, and Ms. Lauren will come around to you with the microphone. State your name and who your question is directed towards.
You'll be next. You all have accomplished a lot and have great accolades, and I'm a Xavier graduate as well. You can tell. I just wanted to ask, of your accomplishments, what are you the most proud of?
I'm getting old enough that I'm wearing hearing aids and I still can't hear. They don't mean a
of
thing.
Of your accomplishments, what are you most proud of?
Oh!
And this is a really an easy one. And people ask me, what was I most proud about as a? I was most proud to be able to stand on the stage and watch you stand. Remember on that little step before your name was called? And to watch the faces of those graduates saying to themselves, oh my God, I made it. Thank God, I made it. And that made me so proud that I had worked with a group of people who made these young people proud themselves. Because I saw every Xavierite like me. I saw you like I was, and that whatever you needed, that I had to have the responsibility to help make sure you got it, to make yourself and your mama and your daddy and your uncle and your grandma and paran proud. And that's what I'm proud of. And the last thing I'm gonna say, because you know, I was taught to talk. I made a 6-city tour Los Angeles, Washington, New York, Atlanta, Houston. And I think there must have been at least 250 at the dentist, 300, and I know I took 150 pictures. And I know the photographer was as mad as he could be, because I'd stand up in the wall and just stand, and before I'd let you leave, I'd say, "What are you doing now?" I was blown away to hear so many of these young people tell me what they were doing. That made me so proud. There were four girls, incidentally, who came together and danced up to take the picture, and they said, "We are all lawyers." I said, "Oh my God."
Well, other than being married to the same woman for 46 years, my biggest accomplishment, I think, I was the first black instructor hired at UNO, and that was significant because I went there when they didn't want black students. And I remember when I walked in and introduced myself, and even though two whites walked out, indicated that I was the instructor, there were two black workmen outside the door, and they were watching. And see, he's teaching. So that was probably the most proudest moment in my career.
Well, I would have to say it's this restaurant. Because when I came aboard, black people had nothing but a sandwich shop. And I have a restaurant with tablecloths. I like tablecloths. So I feel good about that, but I'm still working to make it even better. The culinary industry in this city is unbelievable. So I want to be just what Ella Brennan is. I want to be what the Antwines are. I want all that for my people and for all people, because now I have everybody coming. You know, people said, "Leah, you have to move, because if you stay here, our people now can go all over. And they're not going to come to you here in this area." But nope, I said, "You can't change yourself. You have to be who you are." So I stayed there, and I'm going to stay there. I've been there 75 years. Going to make it work for another 75 years. So
okay. Well, my question is this. As you esteemed panelists already know, America's fought over 100 wars since it came into being. History teaches that there's a just war and there are unjust wars. Can anyone on the panel expound on whether or not it was just for us to participate in World War II?
Yeah, I think it was. Let me tell you, your country is like your mother and your daddy. If your mother and your father are drug addicts, they're your mother and your father. That's all you know. This is our country. That's all we know. Good or bad, it was all we knew. So we had to defend that. Then we had to defend our country and come back home and make it better. But you have to defend what is yours. This is your country. I feel it was my country. No matter how they treated me or how I was treated, it's still the only country I knew. So we have to fight for that and come back home and make it work.
Good evening. I am so fortunate to be in this same space and time with you ladies and gentlemen. This is really directed to Mrs. Chase, because at your age, I just hope that at my age and 1 year plus what you're doing, I'm able to turn to Dr. Francis and say, this is what the question was. I don't know if I heard you correctly, but and maybe you could clarify this, and you made a remark about questioning authority. And I have always been the one who's questioned authority and said the emperor doesn't have any clothes. And if Rosa Parks hadn't questioned authority, or Dr. King, or Malcolm X, Marcus Garvey, Frederick Douglass, we might not have been here in this area. So could you clarify, for my purposes, what did you mean about questioning authority? Because some of those people that are in authority did not have our well-being in mind. And I must say that I'm sure glad they're taping this, because you sure make a lot of sense.
She said respect authority.
Oh, respect authority. Thank you, Susan. Because I've been accused of not respecting authority. For some reason or another, I have no clue as why.
Well, I got. Well, where's my man over there? He questioned my authority every day I saw him at Xavier. and I did. He's still with me, and I love him to death. You have to choose, as a rational individual, if you believe strongly in the fact that the authority has not treated you fairly. You use the, and I'm talking the workplace, wherever you are, you use the, what we call the audit trail to express why you have not been treated right and question the authority that has done it. Now, that might take some chutzpah, you know, willing to be failed or to be fired, but you have, and you owe it to yourself, if there is something that has been done incorrectly for you that might also be impacting others, you have to do it, as we were talking about, respectfully, but you can question authority. You know, anybody who really is a leader and who is in authority ought to be big enough to hear something that, quote, they might not like to hear. And you will know whether that person is a authority or leader. A leader doesn't want people to come and tell them what they think you want to hear. I spent, you know, decades, and I'd say to people, don't come tell me what you think I want to hear. I'm a big boy. Tell me what you want to say so I can decide whether you and I can solve that problem. But don't keep it away. The worst thing you can do is let a company, if you're with, having somebody running it down and the president doesn't know it, and before you know it, nobody wants to work in the place until you might have questioned that authority. I think you've got a right to do it, but I think you've got to be smart. I tell people all the time, again, about being freedom. Don't you think you can run across the Pontchartrain Expressway and take a risk that you're going to get to the other side? You know, you don't need to take those kinds of risks. And if you've got a wife and five children and that's the only job you got, I'm not sure you'd want to question the authority now. You know, you got to be rational about it, and I think that's the important issue. You have to be rational about what it is that you're questioning, and is it the time to question it, and will you do any good by questioning it? Okay. Yeah. It reminds me, and I have to say this. In 1960. Summer of 1963, I was sent to Birmingham. Well, there were several of us, but I got lucky. They liked the way I walked. So I got Birmingham, Tampa, Florida, Jackson, Mississippi, and of all places, Coral Gables.
Oh, my Lord.
I was sent there by the Attorney General of the United States, Robert Kennedy, and his brother, John F. Kennedy, sent to Birmingham. I'm Birmingham, and I stayed in the little motel. I can't remember.
Yes.
Gaston's Motel. Gaston was the richest black man in Birmingham.
Yeah.
He had a big building. He had a pharmacy store.
Funeral
Two
home.
Of them were pharmacists with Xavier Wright. And I get there that night, and I'm in Birmingham. And my job was to get the federal FHA, which was under the what you call HUD, to start hiring blacks above the mop and broom level. Now, these boys from Boston, Kennedy boys from Boston, talked to Bull Connor, and said to Bull Connor, now, what are you going to do? When are you going to start hiring people in city government in Birmingham, black people above the map, pop and blah, blah. And you know what Bull Connor's answer was? We're going to do it when you do it.
Yep.
What do you mean? We hire people irrespective of their race or their color. So I go to Birmingham. I walked in that building, I'll never forget this all the days of my life. I'm there representing the President of the United States and the Attorney General and the regional, it's a beautiful building incidentally, and I walked in and a man came down the steps, nice, suave, and he said, I know who you are. I said, yes sir, I said, but I don't know who you are. He said, well, I'm the regional director and I want to tell you something right now. He say, we have no vacancies here. Now he must have, I looked at him, and then I'm gonna be professional. I'm here with the authority of the President of the United States to make sure that you get an African-American, a few of them, working in this building, and you telling me you have no vacancies. I just looked at him and said, well, sir, you will when I leave. Now, the point I'm making is that you have people that high and they have such blinders that they have to be challenged. Now, you got to know I found the folks. I went underground and found the folks. And I also let the Attorney General of the United States know he had a regional director that should have retired 2 years ago.
Now that's what you call.
I don't think he had a job when I left either.
That's what you call diplomacy.
That's diplomacy.
We want to thank you all for being here tonight, and how about a big round of applause for our panelists?
All right, thank you all for coming, taking your time out from your busy evening to join us. I think I'm gonna get a jar of Vaseline. So if you see me in the morning, I'm all shiny. Miss Chase convinced me that that's what I need, some Vaseline, so thank you so much. All right.
This has truly been a compelling, lively, enjoyable, inspiring discussion from three legends. And I want to encourage you all to explore this museum. This is your museum. This is the foremost museum in the nation, chronicling the lives, the history, and the legends of the people who are represented by the three people here on this stage called the greatest generation that preserved our democracy. Thank you for being here. Lauren?
I'd like to thank Norman Robinson and Susan Isaacs and our panelists and you all for coming tonight. Please be sure to take a programming guide on your way out. We have a couple of film screenings, but a event in April 21st where we'll have a daytime symposium where we'll have Dr. Cassimere and Mr. Robinson, and we'll have Tuskegee Airmen here that night to dedicate our P-51, and we hope you'll join us. So please look at the rest of the programming for Fighting for the Right to Fight, and thank you for coming out tonight.